who do we fear and why do we fear and whom shall we fear? Fear comes into it in a proper place. You know, our fear, our reverence of God is the thing that needs to motivate us. You know, I think that has a huge part to play in our salvation. You know, why would anybody get saved if they didn't have some sense of in our heart having an accountability to God? You know, that fear, that accountability to it. Can God's word help us to relieve these fears? Does that help? It sure helps me. Okay, I want to start in the most famous part in the Bible, I'm sure, to help us relieve our fears. All right, John 3:16. I'm reading from the New Living Translation, and I think we'll have it up here too. For God loved the world so much that he gave his one and only Son, so that everyone who believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. God sent his Son into the world not to judge or condemn the world, but to save the world through him. There is no judgment or condemnation. I like that word condemnation. It's in another translation. That's why I put it in here. There is no judgment or condemnation against anyone who believes in him, but anyone who does not believe in him has already been judged or condemned for not believing in God's one and only Son. And the judgment is based on this fact: God's light came into the world, but people loved the darkness more than the light, for their actions were evil. All who do evil hate the light and refuse to go near it, for fear their sins will be exposed. But those who do what is right come to the light so others can see that they are doing what God wants. Does that resonate with you, hating the light? I don't want to ask, you know, put your hands up for all of you guys that were scumbags before you were saved, you know. John's volunteering. Yeah. I understand that. I completely understand that. And I completely understand how I lived in darkness, you know, and the things that I did. It's incredible to look back on some of that stuff, and much of that I could not even begin to bring to the light in a mixed audience, especially with children, you know. But there was a time that I hated that I didn't want any part of it. I was so against God because God didn't love me. God didn't care for me. You know, my upbringing, you know, the list goes on and on. We have a million excuses of why we do or don't like something, you know. So coming to the light was an amazing thing. And coming to the light for myself was an amazing process that God used another person, which he does, for all of us, used another person to begin to draw me to the light. And that was to see somebody else's life change. And that's what piqued my interest, gave me a little taste of something better than what I was living in, something far greater than anything I had experienced before. So when it comes to John 3:16, we don't have to wait till the end of our life to be condemned. We don't have to. We're condemned already.
Yes, we are.
That's amazing, you know? And I think a lot of our witnessing goes along the line that, you know, well, you'll be condemned if you don't believe in Christ. You know, we've got the cart before the horse. We're condemned already. I knew I was condemned. I absolutely knew it, but I didn't want to deal with it. You know, and so knowing that fact that we're condemned already and coming into the light and accepting Christ as our Savior is the greatest thing that we can do as a human being that God has ever placed on this earth. That we can take that condemnation that belongs to us and bring it to Christ and come into the light and accept Christ as our Savior. So to me, God's word can certainly help us to relieve our fears. Now, another thing, does it help you to know what God says you are in Christ? Does it help you? It helps me. Lots of things help me. Let me go to this one, if I can find it. Okay. In 1 Peter chapter 2, 9 and 10, I bet you can sing this with me. I bet you don't want me to sing. We are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people that belong to God, who has brought us out of darkness into his marvelous light. You know, that's what God says of us. Doesn't say anything about, you know, our past sins, our past anything. It says we are, in verses 2-9, you are not like this. He's talking about what people used to be. For you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's very own possession. As a result, you can show others the goodness of God. For he called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you had no identity as a people, now you are God's people. Once you received no mercy, now you have received mercy. That's what God thinks of us. Okay, so how on earth did all of this come to us? How do we fit into this? Let's go to Romans. Chapter 3. Okay, Romans 3:23. Very popular verse. For everyone has sinned. We all fall short of God's glorious standard. Yet God, with undeserved kindness, declared that we are righteous. How did this? He did this through Christ Jesus when he freed us from the penalty of our sins. For God presented Jesus as a sacrifice for sin. People are made right with God when they believe that Jesus is sacrifice his life, shedding his blood. This sacrifice shows that God was being fair when he held back and did not punish those who sinned in times past, for he was looking ahead and included them in what he would do in this present time. God did this to demonstrate his righteousness, for he himself is fair and just, and he declares sinners to be right in his sight when they believe in Jesus. We can't get better stuff than that. We absolutely can. I have a couple stories. I like stories. Years and years ago, and this has to do with our witness and our sharing of what God has done for us. Years ago, it was way over 20 years now, I went to the hospital really sick. And it was one of those deals where it looked like I might die. And I went there, and so after I was settled in a room and everything like that, Karen came in, and she asked, what she could bring me. I says, well, bring me my Bible and a couple other things I asked for. And I had that purpose in my heart. While I was there, I was going to read the book of Romans. That was my favorite book, you know. So she brings my Bible in, and there was a little old man in the bed next to me. He was the cutest little guy. You know, you'd want to adopt him as your grandpa. And his name was Eddie Hazier. And it turns out he was first cousin to the men that started Hagar Slacks. There was just a difference in how they pronounced it. So Eddie, you know, knew something about popularity and success and things like that. And so after Karen got the book in and she left, and I opened it up, and talk about an easy witness, Eddie looks over and he says to me, "If you see anything in there that you think I need to know about, just read it out and let me know." I never in my life had anybody say that, you know. I thought, wow, you know, is witnessing this easy or what, you know? So I did, you know, and just amazing. We struck up such a good relationship. He was a Catholic man, a Catholic all his life, and he shared his heart with me in such a great way. You know, he was pretty sick himself, you know. And he says, "I've been to church all my life, but I don't honestly know if I'm going to go to heaven." And so I shared with him the famous Romans road, 3:23 and, you know, 6:23 and 5:8 and 10:9 and 10. And as I get to that, you know, we'd share it. And we'd talk about the Lord and everything like that. Well, Eddie accepted Christ as his Savior. And it was so cool, you know, to be blessed to be a part of that, which I wouldn't have been unless I was sick, you know. So everything has its place, you know, like just like Ecclesiastes says, there's a time for everything, you know. There was a time for me to be there and you know, maybe get some priorities straightened out myself, be used by the Lord to help work in somebody else's life. So as far as what God can do in us and through us and with us, there is no limit at all. So you have people like that that are such an easy witness, and then you have people that are a very hard witness, you know. So what do you pass over the hard witnesses? Hard witness for me was my father. Karen knows a lot, you know, about my life growing up and everything. My life growing up was miserable. You know, didn't have, it had its fun times, of course, you know, we all do. You know, we make our fun with, you know, the neighbor kids and all the things we do. But my dad was a hard man. He was a godless man. And he was not somebody easy to witness to. And I asked my mom years later about my father. I says, "What was his impression of me when I was a little kid?" And I was a grown man at this time, and so she told me, you know, it was hard to hear. But she told my father when she was pregnant that she was pregnant with me. His response was, "I don't want that GD kid." So that's how things started out. You know, thank God that is so opposite of what our Heavenly Father is, who says, "Come to me, all of you, no matter what you are." You know, and there was so much of life that Dad just lived that out in his life. Amazing. I don't, you know, I still don't understand what motivates a person to be like that. But fast forward years later, when through the grace of God, I became a Christian, Karen was a Christian, we got married and started a family, and my dad was, by then, divorced from my mom. And he married his childhood sweetheart. She was the child. She's 5 years older than I was, you know. And so they had two children and moved to Pennsylvania. I have a half sister and a half brother in Pennsylvania named Bonnie and Clyde. I said to Dad, I said, "Dad, don't you ever go to the movies or watch TV or anything like that?" I said, "Bonnie and Clyde were criminals, you know." "Well, I like the name." But I tried to witness to him, and my hatred for Dad only changed after God put in my heart a love for him.
Yes.
And it was not my love for him. It was his love.
Yes.
And it was a process. It was a true process to get over this hatred for my dad, you know. And I'd witnessed to him, and he just didn't want to hear any of this, you know. And I witnessed to him about how Jesus died for our sins and all this stuff. And, you know, it's like, you know, I don't know if he even was going in one ear and out the other. I have no idea. But anyway, fast forward a few years, we got a call that their house burned down in Pennsylvania. And destroyed it. You know, they had a little stove out in the, like a foyer, like a porch foyer. And it caught on fire one night, and they had a little dog that stayed out there. That's where it slept, you know, by the stove. Well, the dog woke them up with its barking and carrying on. And here, I don't know, circumstances make no difference. But anyway, the dog barked and barked and barked and woke them up, you know. And they were able to get out of the house and be saved. But the dog was not. And that's the first time in my life I ever saw my father cry. And he's crying, you know, he's getting with it, you know. He says, that little dog saved our life. He died for us, you know, because they couldn't get it out. And I says, Dad, that's what I've been trying to tell you about Jesus. That he died for us. He gave his life, you know. And that probably was the first time it might have started to click with him, you know. But it's just, you know, just this ongoing life, a hard life with him, a hard witness to him. And go faster forward to the end of his life. I'm trying to get through this. He's laying in the hospital in Oil City, PA, dying of cancer, which he didn't have to because he was too ornery and too stubborn to go to the doctor for prostate cancer, which, you know, most of us guys know if you catch that pretty early, you're in pretty good shape. But he wouldn't go, you know. So my stepmother asked me, come over, Dad wanted to see me. I said, okay. So I go to the house, they'd built a new house. Go to the house, pick her up, and we're driving to Oil City. And she hesitantly says, Lee, your dad asked me one thing. I says, okay. He doesn't want you to preach to him today. He doesn't want you to talk to him about God. And by now, you know, I mean, this is years later. We've been going through this process. I said, okay. So I thought, you know, everything has been done that can be done. If this is how he wants it, this is how it is. So I go there and I start talking with him and everything like that. And I'm just letting him talk and everything like that. Probably 5 minutes into the whole situation, he brings up God. So I had a good talk with him, you know, about salvation and just everything. He wanted to talk about it, all kinds of things, from the nation of Israel to, I don't know where he came up with that one, but to, you know, so we had that conversation. A few days later, he dies. And so the hard witness versus the easy witness was such a strain. But I think that my father, in however he did it, however God did it, I think that he accepted Christ. And I look forward to that day to see if he's there or not. You know, I look forward to seeing little Eddie Hazier there too, because he was a cool little guy. And so it doesn't matter how easy or hard life is for us, what we're going through, whether it's sadness or sorrow or disease or you name it. You know, God uses us in the most incredible circumstances and situations, because there are people in those same incredible circumstances and situations that need the Lord. You know, it's just how life is. God didn't use somebody that was handsome and noble and rich and wealthy and come and buy me out and say, you know, I know you're struggling, I'll give you this and everything like that if you'll accept Christ. No, he didn't use that at all. You know, he used Karen's cousin, who was just a mom, you know, a plain, fiery, redheaded mom, you know. So, I guess I've spent far too much time on that, but I'll go on here. So what should our response be to the outpouring of love and grace God has given to us? In Philippians, he instructs us here. Philippians chapter 2. Verses 1 to 4. Is there any encouragement from being a Christian, belonging to Christ? Any comfort from his love? Any fellowship together in his spirit? Are your hearts tender and compassionate? Then make me truly happy. This is Paul speaking here, by agreeing wholeheartedly with each other, loving one another, working together with one mind and purpose. Don't be selfish. Don't try to impress others. Be humble, thinking of others as better than yourselves. Don't look out only for your own interests, but take an interest in others too. And then 14 and 16 says, do everything without complaining and arguing, so that no one can criticize you. Live clean, innocent lives as children of God, shining like bright lights in a world full of crooked and perverse people. That was me. Hold firmly to the word of life. Then, on the day of Christ's return, I will be proud that I did not run the race in vain and that my work was not useless. So Paul instructs us through the word of God of how we should do everything. You know, of basically what he's saying is, church, which is us, don't bring shame to God by how we live. Don't complain, don't criticize, you know, don't backbite, don't slander, reserve our lives just for ourselves and our own successes or failures or anything like that, you know. He wants us to be the body that we are and to love one another, care for one another, cherish one another as he does. Okay. So I have to ask this hard question, and we all have to answer it. Are we under any obligation or responsibility to share Christ with others? What do you think of that? Why is that? Okay. It's not an option, is it? It really isn't an option. 2 Timothy 4, verses 1 to 5. I solemnly urge you in the presence of God and Christ Jesus, who will someday judge the living and the dead when he appears to set up his kingdom, preach the word of God. That's not just to the preachers. That's not just to Timothy. That's to all of us. Be prepared whether the time is favorable or not. Patiently correct, rebuke, and encourage your people with good teaching. For a time is coming when people will no longer listen to sound and wholesome teaching. They will follow their own desires and will look for teachers who will tell them whatever their itching ears want to hear. They will reject the truth and chase after myths. How many of you are taking a part in a home group that's watching the Truth Project? What do you think so far? Neil?
Well, I mean, it's awesome. It's got such great conversation. Mm-hmm. And yes, it doesn't shy away from telling that, you know, it's our duty to go out and spread the truth in a world that doesn't want to hear it.
Yeah. Yeah, isn't it so true that there is that generation right now that either don't want anything to do with God, or they have their own idea of what it's all about, and that's it, you know. Whether it's that crazy woman, Unitarian preacher, or whatever she is. If you haven't seen the Truth Project, you don't know what I'm talking about, but this woman is out there, really out there. I'm glad we don't have ladies like that here. Okay, all right. So I go back to this question. Today, where would you be if someone had not shared with you what Jesus had done for you? Where would you be? What if your parents, Eric, had not brought you up in a Christian family where you eventually had to make your own decision to follow Christ yourself and not just continue in your mom and dad's relationship with the Lord? Where would you be, Carol? Jason, where would you be? Vince, I could go on and on. Where would be? We have to ask ourselves that question. Where would we be? It's just, that's the stark reality of life. It's something that somebody told us in our need. And sometimes the need was light as a young child. When, you know, and I think, you know, I think of that. You know, I love children. I just, you know, the older I get, the more I love kids. You know, and I can't tell you how enjoyable it is to have 14 Amish kids to take to school every day. These kids are so precious to me, you know, and to watch them and just see their lives growing up and everything, and see what they sing about and what they talk about when they speak English and you know, stuff like that. But just to see our children and see the promise that they have in them, and to know that if we don't share the Lord with them in our daily living, who will? You know, that was not shared in my life when I was growing up. Not at all, you know. But that is such an incredible process, an incredible thing that God does for us, to give us somebody, no matter who it is, if it's a complete stranger or a mom or a dad, to give us somebody that will share the love of God with us. So it is an incredible responsibility, but it's also an incredible privilege. I think we have a song that is so important. I love this song. I've loved it for years. One of my favorite things to do, it doesn't take much to entertain me. One of my favorite things to do is to sit in a parking lot at Walmart or Save-A-Lot or something like that and just watch the people. Watch them coming and going. Watch the expressions on their face. Some, you know, come in with their kids, and the kids are just skipping along, and, you know, I mean, it's, they're like little vibrating, you know, toys or something. And just enjoying life, and moms and dads trying to hold on to them, and grandpas and grandmas. I see so many people that are so crippled up, and I whine and complain about, you know, how I feel, but I see people that just are dragging themselves to the store and the pain on their face and everything like that. And I see these people, and I see some that are so determined to get in and out. And, you know what I'm talking about. The list is endless of what people look like and what's going on in their heart and everything like that. And I see them dressed in everything imaginable. I don't even want to tell you about the, no, I won't tell you about the, the YouTube thing you can see about the people of Walmart. It's incredible. But the stark reality is, the words of this song tell us so much about people. So if you're ready, Kirk.
I can see it in their eyes. Empty people filled with care, headed who knows where. On they go through private laughter hides their silent cries. Only Jesus hears. People need the Lord. People need the Lord. At the end
John 3:1 says, "See how very much our Father loves us, for he calls us his children, and that is what we are. But the people who belong to this world don't recognize that we are God's children because they don't know him. Dear friends, we are already God's children, but he has not yet shown us what we will be like when Christ appears. But we do know that we will be like him, for he will see us as he really is, and all who have this eager expectation will keep themselves pure, just as he is pure. I'd like Tor and Jessica to come up. As we all know, Jesse's really been going through some physical struggles. And you as the body, I would invite anyone who wants to come and pray with them to please come up. This is what we get to do. We don't only get to share our love with this world, which we're instructed to do, but thank God we're part of a body that loves one another, cares for one another,